like you're not able to talk to him every day. Just so you know.
Did you want to know about the dog house?
She said, well, we'll find out what the hot spot is.
It's like a tornado.
When we get there. Thank you.
Yeah, they just.
Wait, see if my daughter saw. This is the headlight from SU.
Welcome everybody to the first meeting of the Board of Education for 2014-2015 school year. It is our annual reorganization meeting. And first order of business is the election of chairman, chairperson, I should say. And I'll seek nominations for that. Bob Mills, chair. Second?
Second.
Lisa, second. Any other nominations? All those in favor?
Aye.
At this point, I'd like to have the pledge of allegiance. Pledge allegiance.
To the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. At this point, it is appointment of the Board of Education for the 2014-2015 school year. It's recommended that Debbie Pyle be appointed to the clerk. Motion?
Motion.
Jim Stevens, second. Beth Sides, all in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries. And at this point, we have the administration vote to newly elected board member Pam King. And we'll administer that oath at this point. Are you going to do that, please?
Ms. King, the oath that you are signing states that you will support the constitutions of the United States and the state of New York, and that you will perform your duties as a Board of Education member to the best of your ability.
Sign.
It's just about the same.
At this point, oh, that's correct. That's Jim Stevens, you said board member, that's correct. So let's administer the oath to Jim Stevens for his new term.
The oath that you are signing states that you will support the constitutions of the United States and the state of New York, and that you will perform your duties as a Board of Education member to the best of your ability.
Okay, at this point, I will seek nominations for the president of the Board of Education.
Nominate John Jadam. Second.
Second, Pam King. Any other nominations? Nominations are closed. All in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries 7-0. You need to administer the oath as the president.
Thank you.
Mr. Jadam, the oath that you are signing states that you will support the Constitution of the United States and the state of New York, and that you will perform your duties as the Board of Education president to the best of your ability.
I will. Congratulations, John. At this point, I'll turn the meeting over to you.
Thank you, Mr. Knoll. And now I would ask for nomination for vice president of the board.
Nominate Paul McCarthy.
Second?
Second.
Any other nominations? This point, nominations are closed. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries 7-0. Congratulations, Paul.
Petrowski, the oath that you are signing states that you will support the constitutions of the United States and the state of New York, and that you will perform your duties as the Board of Education vice president to the best of your ability.
I will.
All right, Paul, we're up to the
recommend that the following appointment of officers be approved. Superintendent of Schools, Robert J. Noel. District Treasurer, Kimberly Hibbert. Deputy District Treasurer, Denise Owens. Tax Collector, Robin Kennedy. Claims Auditor, Wendy Stillman. School Physician, Dr. Christopher Alina. Lisa Bosse's. School Attorney, Anthony Halleck. District Auditor, Jeremy Burke and Brown. Extra Classroom Activity Fund Treasurers. And the Senior High School, it's the Senior High School Office Specialist. And the Junior High School, it's the Junior High School High Office Specialist. The Asbestos Designee is Andrew Morgan. And the Records Management Officer, Mary Mandel.
Move.
Second?
Second.
Discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Carried, seven zero. Designations.
It is recommended to approve the following designations. Official Bank Depositories. The attached list would be First Niagara Bank for all deposit of all funds and all accounts. Financial Consultant, Bernard P. Donegan Incorporated. Official Newspaper, The Observer Dispatch. And approval of meeting dates and locations for the attached list.
Have a motion?
Move.
Second?
Second.
Discussion?
Anything changed, Mary?
December, September 2nd, we're meeting on the day after Labor Day. There's no school anywhere.
We'll be at the minutes in service conference.
First day conference.
Yes. So we'll also have students.
Can we test it for the school?
It's possible to be able to schedule this as well. Many times we have.
So for Tuesday and Wednesday, teachers will be, I'm sorry, Wednesday?
Tuesday and Wednesday and Thursday, it's the start of school.
Thursday starts school. So the opening day is, opening is Tuesday morning, like, correct? And so will you send out invitations? I know a lot of times we all went to that breakfast to sort of also look at that.
Yes. And it doesn't conflict with the Jewish holidays?
No, no, no.
No, we already covered that, would be only seven scheduled.
It should be noted too that August 14th, and it will, their 14th meeting is on a Thursday.
As there's an asterisk at the bottom, but thank you for pointing that out.
Is there a factor that you, of the, what do you?
Sorry?
The dates, is that?
Should I? Oh, yeah, we'll get you.
Thank you.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Yes? Mrs. Corey, would you like a copy of?
Yes, please.
Sorry. Motion passes seven zero. Authorizations.
It is recommended that the following authorizations be approved. Payroll Certification, Mary Mandel. School Purchasing Agent, Mary Mandel.
Move.
Sorry.
Sorry. Established Petty Cash and Change Funds. $100 for all of the school buildings. $100 for the business office. And $80 for the athletic office for change fund. The Petty Cash Custodians at the school buildings, they will be the office specialists. The business office is the account clerk. And the athletic office is John Bergantino. Authorized signatures on check would be the district treasurer. School safety deposit would be the board president, the board clerk, assistant superintendent for business affairs. Agreements with other school districts to transport students would be the superintendent of schools. Authorized signatures for extra classroom activity accounts. At the senior high, there are two signatures. It would be the office specialist and the senior high principal and or dean of students. And at Perry Junior High, we would have two signatures, which would be the office specialist and the principal. And finally, the agreement for services for the school resource officer program would be the superintendent of schools.
Has anything changed?
Moved.
Second?
Second.
Discussion?
Yes. Mary, didn't we have for the signatures on one check, one signature on a check,
Can we have a backup at one point, because Kim was absent or something? Somebody came down for a junior high or?
That's the deputy treasurer item that we just went through prior to the appointments. Appointments officer.
Item six.
Deputy treasurer Denise.
So she has authority also to use it with?
Correct. They're all by the.
Discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Motion passes.
Seven zero. If I may, the Board of Education meeting dates and all this other material is online.
Okay. And point of clarification, Paul brought up that I have four, I have six appointment of office manager by oath. So all of these people take an oath outside board.
That's right.
Item ten, readoption of bylaws of the Board of Education.
It is recommended that the bylaws of the Board of Education be readopted.
Move.
Second. Discussion?
I just have a question under the committee meetings. Is there a format for when said all board members shall be notified of committee meetings and they attend if they desire to do so? How is that communicated?
Friday communication.
It is.
The rest of the meetings, upcoming schedule for the week.
For the committees as well.
Yeah, and they're also online in the calendar too.
I don't know if it's appropriate here, but we had talked about in the bylaws, making sure everyone's on the same page with the expectations and duties of the president. So that there's no misunderstanding. Is now appropriate time to talk about that, or should that be a separate motion?
It is appropriate time.
Okay.
There's a discussion.
Okay. And so what we had talked about again is the expectation is the president will meet with Bob to help set the agenda, will not act as a gatekeeper for items, but will simply be a facilitator, making sure that the agenda is set. So it might be that one agenda meeting is too full until we say we're going to put it on another. The board president will be the single point of contact for the media, so that if the OD calls, the president could answer. The letters to the editor as president, that would only be done if the board approves the article before it goes to the paper. So in other words, we don't want the president or anybody writing an article as a board member. Signing letters, other than simple congratulations letters, any letter of substance, the board would see before the president signs. Other business? No?
No, I'm listening.
Okay. Other business, again, ideally, everything will be conveyed to Bob or myself before the meeting so that we can prepare for it. But if there, something does come up, you bring it up in other business, but it may simply be, thank you for bringing that up, we'll look into it. But in a perfect world, there won't be a lot of items in other business brought up by board members. But the reality is, it is.
So if you want something on the agenda, what's the procedure for that? We would contact you and say, John, I'd like this on the agenda, contact Bob, or what's the procedure?
What's it been in the past?
Either or.
Either or.
Okay.
What's the difference between that and the sitting down and developing the agenda? You know what I mean?
Well, that goes into it, so I think it's all a matter of timing. So if there are issues that are brought up before Bob and I sit down and put the agenda together, that would obviously be part of the discussion. If something was brought to our attention after we sat down, then it would be probably just put under other business for Bob to bring up.
The only other thing I want to mention is discussions with the media, discussions based upon things that we've already discussed in open session and had a consensus upon.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Well, I mean, I'm not going to talk about, first of all, I don't want to.
Something's going to happen.
Right, but for instance, perfect example, I got a call and I declined because I was not yet elected president. The OD called and asked me to comment upon all state testing having to be done online in the future and whether or not Hartford was ready for it. Okay. Now, that's an example of, honestly, I would defer to Bob and Alan.
Right. Because we don't know, so you can't speak on our behalf.
Right. So that's where I just, I will do my best. And when in doubt, I will say little, but, you know, this woman has my direct line now. I'm not sure how she got it, but.
Can you just clarify the content of the meeting, because I'm not clear on what I just meant. I was under the impression that you would be the sole contact for the project.
Well, I think what I was meaning, so if we came out.
Well, I'm here. What I was meaning was, is that, speaking for the board on things not yet discussed, speaking for the board to the OD on things not yet voted upon and had consensus upon is not.
I think the perfect example is when I got the call about computer testing. They were looking not for a board action, they were looking for comment. And that's where I get a little fuzzy as to what is appropriate to say and not say. I don't want to be acting as if I'm hiding something, but at the same time, you know, it's easy if we voted on Alan's contract and they call up and they say, you know, could you please comment on that action? Of course, you know, blah, 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 blah. That's no brand. It gets trickier, I think, when there's a question. It's kind of just not based on some board action.
Right. And so therefore, I mean, that's you know, again, the answer to that question, maybe, hey, the board hasn't discussed it, so I got no comment. You know, maybe our superintendent does, and maybe we can bring this up and put it on the agenda for discussion so we can get back with you, but, you know.
I mean, it's a fine line, because you don't want to look like you're not being cooperative.
Right.
Because this was a very pleasant conversation. She was trying to write an article on Common Core. It was about to take it as a gotcha type question.
Right.
She was looking for some information. So
as a board president, so if the OD wrote an article that had some misconceptions, so if we decided that we wanted to respond, let's say you and Bob and whoever just called aside to respond, we would be able to send a response into, what would be the procedure for that? How would that be? Or what about individual board members writing letters to the editor as individuals? Is that okay?
Well, I mean, as far as an official board response, an article like a guest view of the president of the Board of Education, I think that type of article needs to have a full backing of the board, and I would think that everybody needs to be able to see that and weigh in on it and vote on it, and then we go forward. You know, as far as individuals writing as individuals, I mean, that's that slippery thing. You have the First Amendment right, but you're always wearing your board hat. But, you know, so you kind of have to, I don't think we can legislate policy. And I think that's just the usual best judgment. And we go through this. If I'm doing something that you guys don't want me to do, please tell me. I will never do anything with the intent of trying to overstep the authority of the grant, okay? So, we're in this together, just let me know, and we can talk about it, and we'll go from there, okay? Any further discussion on the bylaws?
Yeah, I just had a question, too, and I don't know if it's appropriate to bring it up now. We have talked about adding a committee. We have all the committees listed here. So, potentially, is that something we've discussed further?
That will be on the agenda.
Okay.
So do you see a change in the bylaws?
There's been talk about adding not a standing committee.
No, I'm talking about the duties of the president.
You know, I don't know if the board feels, I just wanted to clarify that fuzzy, perform such other duties as they customarily involve. So I was trying to just be sure we're on the same page with what has customarily evolved as a duty of the president. I don't believe anything I've articulated is something new, but I just wanted to be sure.
Well, it's something new. Some of the stuff is. I agree with you.
So I would defer to the board whether or not they think it's needed or if having this discussion.
I just think that any time that anybody represents himself as the board, as the position of the board, then that needs to be approved by the board. That's it. I mean, that's, it doesn't matter if it's the president or for me.
So can we put something under here that states that, under duties of the president? Communication still.
Customarily involved would be thank you notes.
Well, no, I agree with that. I think customarily involved would be, you know, meeting with Bob to set the agenda.
Okay.
You know, being the main point of contact for the meeting, things like that, so.
Yeah, it says, or as maybe prescribed by the board, so if we're prescribing that to you right now, then.
So, I mean, so the question is, do we want to amend the bylaws to specifically include that, or is this enough?
Well, I think it's enough, and then I think if we find it, it should be codified.
Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Close. Extentions, passes seven zero. And that, I believe, concludes the reorganization meeting. So can I have a motion to adjourn the reorganization meeting?
Second.
All in discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Against? Abstained, motion passes seven zero. So now I would like to call to order the regular meeting of the Board of Education, July 8th. First item, approval of minutes of June 3rd and 17th, 2014, regular meeting.
Move.
Second. Discussion?
Yes. The minutes are from June 3rd and June 17th. I'm just wondering if there's any way that we can get the minutes, hard copy or electronically, either by the Friday letter or at least by the second Friday letter following the meeting, rather than wait. I mean, I can look through these minutes and I can look at them, look in and say, they seem okay. You know, I don't remember from June 3rd who voted on what or was it worded this way. I'm just looking to get the minutes a little sooner. But we don't get the minutes for 2 weeks. At times, we don't get them.
Don't we usually get them each?
Yeah, but the meeting's today.
Yeah,
we may not get them 2 weeks later. And I'm only asking, if they can be
sooner
than 2 weeks.
Earlier than 2 weeks? Is that possible?
So we don't have to write anything up, make a policy. Yeah.
I'm just saying, if it's all possible.
By the Friday of after the meeting?
Or the second Friday.
But don't we always get it by the second Friday after the meeting?
Yeah, yeah.
The next meeting is
that
Tuesday.
Sometimes it's true. Sometimes there is.
So if we had had the June 3rd by the June 17th meeting, is what you're saying.
Well, we would normally do. Usually we get, so the meeting's on Tuesday, and there's a week that transpires, it's every 2 weeks we meet, so we get it by the previous Friday.
Within 10 days. However, sometimes the application is better.
That's why I just want to discuss it, know that in writing, just say, give it a shot.
That's why we'll expect you to come forward and see how.
All in favor?
Aye.
Close. Abstained, motion passes seven zero. Recognition of visitors and delegations. Yes, ma'am.
Hi, I'm Catherine Allison Green. I teach fifth grade at Yorkview Elementary School, and I come to every board meeting as often as possible as the first vice president, executive vice president of the NHGA. So I just want to introduce myself to Pam, really, and what my capacity is here, and welcome you, and welcome Betty, and welcome back to everyone.
Thank you.
And welcome back to you.
Thank you.
I would also just like to add that once the school year starts, especially with Mary Kate, my daughter Mary Kate's going to be a senior this year.
Wow.
And I talked to my executive board, and when at all possible, if there's an event that she is playing in, because she plays many sports, I will be going to her events. It's her season, and I will be having substitutes in here. So feel free to contact me directly if you had a specific question for me, but people will be here taking notes in my absence. Say that.
Well, thank you.
Thank you.
Would anyone else like to address the board? Okay. Correspondence and communications.
Yes, I have a letter from two parents here commending a teacher that was their child's first grade teacher, so I distributed that. And I also have thank you parents here from former assistant superintendent Conville and from former district clerk Trico for more education. And that concludes correspondence and communications. Thank you.
Board committee reports, PG&T.
Okay, for June 4th, we've got the long-range facility plan, the future capital project planning. Very excited to overview the process and planning stages that led up to the capital project proposal, including recommendations made by the facilities advisory committee. The facilities advisory report, a proposed capital facilities project recommendation, including the preliminary project estimates for two separate propositions, building and site renovations, technology upgrades, new transportation facility, and estimated financial impact reports were distributed and presented by Mrs. Mandel, Mr. Morgan, and Mr. Bastian. The BG&T committee will meet in September 2014 to review the potential budgets. Mr. Morgan also gave us the fire inspection report. It took place in the month of April 2014. The district passed the inspection with a few minor nonconformities, which were corrected prior to the due date submission to SED of June. The fire inspection report was approved by the committee. Mrs. Mandel also reviewed with the committee the 2013-14 goals that were established and what has been accomplished to date. To highlight some of the safety measures implemented, such as increased camera coverage and revised transportation drop-off procedures were addressed. And we adjourn that meeting.
Okay, and I'm going to report on the June 17th meeting. Actually, just a change in the minutes there. I actually called the meeting to order at 5:19 because the sun was running a little bit late. We had a safety update, a front entrance review. Dr. Levitino and Mr. Morgan presented an overview on the security event that occurred at Bradley. They presented a plan to improve the security at the front entrances district-wide, so not just at Bradley, but at all the elementary schools that did not that had a window, I'm trying to remember, High School in Bradley. A discussion ensued regarding options and pricing, and the committee agreed that bulletproof glass will be installed at the front attendant windows to Bradley, thank you, Perry, and Senior High School.
Good.
And we turned it back for the second.
And did you get pricing on that?
Yes, Mary, we got pricing on it.
Was it as crazy expensive?
Each window, depending on the size, like the range was they cost $1,800 for this one.
Oh, that's not
crazy pricing was all the doors.
Oh, okay.
This is the window.
Okay. That's great.
I have a question on the June 14th. There's a chart in there. What is existing with the chair?
Good question.
What is this?
Okay, this was one of the charts that was reviewed at that meeting. It goes along with a potential proposed federal project. And that would be the original committee of color. The lighter shaded area above the dark bar in year three, for example, in 2017, would be the first impact that this project would have. So it's keeping level debt, if you will. If you see the very first bar, it's a solid bar all the way up to the line. That line is where our current level debt, the line that goes across horizontally.
So that dark bar is
our local share right now. So
local share means debt? And that
tax. What tax impact? Okay. From capital projects. So our existing mortgage, if you will, for our capital projects is at that line. So as you see, our long-range financial plan is to keep facilities in the condition required by the State Education Department and our five-year facilities plans. We try to, we talked about this at that meeting and all of our facilities meeting was that we try to plan our projects being cognizant of our goals, of what our financial plan is, keeping within that or were slightly below, and as well as, you know, meeting the needs, obviously, of the district. So if you see this, all of this backup that you received is what we reviewed at that meeting, and that financial impact, the borrowing for a project that will not hit until the 16-17 school year, in that lighter shaded area would be the effect of this project. Okay, so currently, our current debt, or local, not debt, our current local share is the dark bar.
So is it good that it's going down?
Well, we have to try and keep it level.
Retiring debt, okay.
That's when you plan for, like, we need, this is a very basic project of replacing roofs that have exceeded, you know, the warranty at this point. And again, the long-range facilities committee that met for over a year, the proposal is on here attached. I mean, committee report you see in multiple meetings, determine the priorities.
Even though it's going down, you don't want it to, like, just go down the way, because then you would, like, lower the tax rate.
Sure.
And then if we have to do a capital project, then it goes up again. You don't want it to go up, down, up, down. You want to sort of keep it consistent all the way.
It's a great looking chart. You know, I think it's a great looking chart. It maintains.
Based on the limit, in that terminology, existing local share.
You don't want to see the spikes and valleys, because then you're bouncing all over the place.
So 2025, where the first, the darker project, if you will, drops off.
Yep.
Ideally, that would be the time that you would add.
It would be like.
So it would be, we talked about in 2021, even right in the middle there, so a lower sum. We do have another summary of the facilities advisory committee already looked at, that looks like this, but with different numbers and some different items, to address the potential need for expansion of our facilities, to address the nano potential impact of this school district on, you know, growth need from the nano or other economic development that potentially will occur in the region. So that is another, it aligns perfectly with our, you know, potential need for the additional items on our facilities advisory committee report.
And part of the other part of that too is also keeping in mind the local share is what is not able by the state, and making sure you're putting together a project that consists of equally able or non-able portions. And that's, it is really a juggling act. We have a consultant that comes in and tells us, okay, this is able, this percent, this is able, this percent, so we're working to keep that line level, and it's not as simple as saying, well, we borrowed $100 last year and paid back 50, we'll borrow another 50. It's really very complex, but.
One more question on the second page, the incidental costs. Those are after the fact of the project, so we've already done some, those costs associated with evaluating the project, correct? Those incidental costs, is that typical for them to be that high?
Yes.
Okay.
There's eight factors involved with incidental costs. These are estimates. This is all estimates. These are pre-architecture, architectural design estimates. So part of the estimating process is we need to put an escalation because of the, you know, timeline of the implementation of the project, plus incidental costs are all of the fees associated with the professionals associated with the capital project, as well as there are so many regulations involved.
Right.
So yes, this is a normal,
that's a typical
incidental cost. Also included in incidental costs, sometimes you'll see site improvements, which is probably really very minimal. It's a small, let's say, improvement proposal.
Questions?
Yeah.
One question I've got is regarding the others present. We're not keeping track we're keeping track of audience members.
Well, usually we don't have audience, and this time I did, so
okay.
I just included me.
Okay.
I mean, it's easy. So I called the meeting to order at 5:30 on June 17th, and Mr. Pfister from Mosley School Lunch Program made a presentation, and he advised us that the school lunch price will be increased by 25 cents, so the school lunch will now be $2.25 in the
school year. This represents the first price increase since the 2008-2009 school year. Mr. Fister stated due to new regulations and increase, the increase is necessary to keep the program fiscally solid. We also got a tax certiorari update from Mary to review. We received the discontinuance that was received regarding TS and Hartford Partners tax certiorari claim. Claim has been discontinued for the year 2008-2012. Requested reduction was the value of $173,374. That's good news. We also got an update on the UPS tax certiorari claim, and Mr. Ryan will be with us, I believe, tonight to discuss some other tax certificates. Meeting is adjourned at 5 o'clock.
Thank you, Mary. I was up at the meeting. I'm not listed on
Yeah, I was there too. I was in the audience, but
did I put you on the other meeting?
I did both of them.
Next up, Policy Committee.
The Policy Committee met on June 25th at 12:03 p.m. The committee reviewed Policy 8501, that's Early Retirement Incentive Program, and regulation. We also discussed 3011.12, Director for Athletics, Health, and Safe Schools. Following a brief discussion, the committee agreed to several changes to Policy 8501. Mr. Noel expressed that the early retirement incentive has been a retention strategy to ensure long-range stability. Mr. Noel also informed the committee that a review of the changes being suggested should be reviewed by legal counsel before being presented to the Board of Education for the first reading. The committee agreed. Mr. Noel will review the changes with legal counsel. The committee reviewed Regulation 3011.12. It'll be submitted to the board tonight. It is recommended that the board waive the first two readings for the regulation and adopt it following the third reading.
That's the director.
And the meeting was adjourned at 12:16.
Thank you, Mr. Stevens. Number five, new business. A, policy. Recommended that the following policy be presented for the first reading, 8501, Early Retirement Incentive Program.
Can I do a discussion for this, or this is just kind of
We don't vote on it yet. We don't vote on it. You can discussion.
So I guess according to these minutes, did you review with the legal counsel? Or that
it's
process?
It's been presented to the legal counsel, yes. And this is the
And then specifically, I just want to know in terms of like, are there, you know, for going forward, are there employees that are grandfathered in here, or how does that work?
Well, I think what we discussed is so that the individual positions called out here are not part of the collective bargaining unit. They each have individual contracts. So as those contracts come up, you know, it would be a negotiated point. However, you know, any new contracts, the policy.
So if somebody has an existing contract, then it's their existing contract, and when they have a new contract, then they push it.
Right, as we discussed with other contracts, if the contract currently gives someone a right to the old policy, we can't unilaterally force that change. But when there is a renegotiation of the contract, there would have to be an amendment to that contract.
Roman numeral 2, letter A, where you have starting with the number 2 crossed out. And what could have followed there?
The thinking there was there was a somewhat disjointed paragraph, and you had two virtually identical paragraphs, except one dealt with professional employees and one dealt with other school employees. And so, because it already said all employees, why have two identical paragraphs? So we just condense them into one. So if you're employed by the district, unless you are in a disqualified position, you are eligible if you meet these criteria.
Okay. Does the non-instructional union have this also?
Yes.
They do?
All employees.
Okay. Okay, so they're still in there, all employees? Okay.
I have a question under the payment schedule. Where it said, employees shall receive a lump sum check. Is there any financial benefit to them or to us or having that option of being paid out so we're not maybe paying a lump sum? I mean, I know these amounts aren't necessarily huge, but something that somebody could say, well, no, I want that paid over 6 months, so it's similar to still getting a salary kind of thing? Or is that too complicated? Is there any discussion?
I'll just be there.
So now, like, the deferrals in each of the contracts, meaning that the money goes into a tax sheltered annuity when they retire, up to the limit of the laws for the tax sheltered annuity, which I believe is 40, at this point, is like 46,000. So anything above that goes into a payroll, so we do benefit as an employee of the tax sheltered.
Okay.
That way.
Okay. So we're not, even while it says lump sum, we're not necessarily...
It is a one-time after, it's after they retire.
Yep.
It's a one-time payment.
But we're paying that into an annuity that would then get paid out to them?
Right, they have to set up an annuity, right.
Okay.
It's called not elected deferral. They don't have a choice. Everybody has to, for tax reasons, everybody has to.
And then anything above that is taxed?
Correct. Through payroll. That goes through payroll.
This would save them quite a taxes.
Yes.
Any other comments?
There's nothing changed. How about regarding, I mean, there's nothing changed from our meeting, the attorney changed or anything like that? This is what we discussed.
I think she just changed, district superintendent, she changed to superintendent of schools.
Okay.
So that was the...
That was it?
I believe that was it. This one was changed. It might have been a typo. Yeah, I think the other one was just the date of board approval, which is scheduled for 3 weeks, being September 16th. That's one of the changes. And then the title from district superintendent to superintendent of schools. Those are the two changes we counseled.
All right, thanks, man.
And then, is there any plan to, again, right now, there's just one position to call it, district, is there any plan to expand that and get this qualified position in the future?
I think that's up to the board. What we talked about previously, you know, the other groups are collectively bargaining groups, so that's going to have to be part of a larger discussion of what the role of the board is, what the pattern of negotiation is.
So principals fall under that?
Principals are with that, are administrators.
Principals have their own negotiation, right?
Principals have their own unit, and then there's administration. Principals are part of the administrative
register,
and the teachers, the employment group, and the non-structural. Okay, moving on to the other policy. We have a discussion on the athletics and health and safe schools.
Yes. It was recommended that the first and second readings be waived and the following regulation be adopted following the third and final readings.
Move.
Discussion.
Yes. What happens to those, is that being incorporated into safe schools?
That assignment and appropriate responsibilities is a superintendent.
Okay. Going down to letter 6D, submitting to the superintendent prior to season, recommend a list of coaching personnel. A little hazier because we know that, I don't know if that's ever happened, we had all coaches submitted. Usually there's a straggler, one or two coaches. So this doesn't mean that the new person, whoever they may be, has them all in prior to the season, does it? I don't want to put somebody under the gun.
No. No, I mean, changes take place, people resign.
Okay.
As long as it's a host of reasons. Recruiting, you know, recruiting of those individuals would prohibit you.
next meeting, I think, about what's going to happen with Dan Pope, who is the chair of the PE department, and also the girls' athletic coordinator is also part of the NHTA bargaining unit. So what happens to Dan Pope, first of all?
Nothing happens to Dan Pope. He's still the chairperson, just like all other chairpersons, and they report to the assistant superintendent for curriculum, just like the chairperson would report to the director of athletics.
So who's developing the district plan for PE?
The director of athletics at Safe Schools, and conjunction with the chairperson, who will give this individual feedback, similar to what happened with the curriculum alignment process or any campus for that department. I had this reviewed by former assistant superintendent, and it said similar to what we do now in the curriculum side of the house.
But the responsibility is now the athletic director, that's correct.
The chair will report to the athletic director and work in conjunction with the director.
And then Dan implements the plan.
Sure.
What all the other key?
Just like a chairperson does now of all their various departments.
Do we need to vote on this reading?
We're waiting the first and second read down the motion.
Now they're going.
Do we get a motion?
Motion.
And now we're in discussion, and we ask, is that being waived?
Second.
There, you have a motion, second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained. Motion carries seven zero.
So you guys in one group?
No.
Oh, the other one's first.
First reading and the other one.
B, personnel, appointments. A, elementary.
It is recommended that Megan Alshheimer is hereby appointed on probation to the academic tenure area of elementary education. The service shall begin on September 1st, 2014, and end on August 31st, 2016. The appointee is certified initial in childhood education, 1 through 6, students with disabilities, birth through grade 2, early childhood education, birth through grade 2, and students with disabilities, grades 1 through 6.
And motion.
Motion.
Second.
Second.
Discussion.
How many resumes were taken for this job?
In about 340.
For just this one, or?
For the elementary.
For the elementary positions.
340?
Yeah. My only observation, you know, is that here we are in an economic time where other districts are suffering. My only observation is that, you know, the level of experience seems to be very low across all three candidates. And, you know, I mean, out of 340 candidates, you would think that there were some, you know, teachers that have been teaching for quite some time that, you know, were directly involved with. That's my only question, you know, regarding that. That's all.
The majority of the applicants were people who were either substituting or had been in long-term substitutions.
Okay.
There weren't a lot of people with a great deal of experience that were applying for the elementary position.
So this is all?
Yeah, most of them.
So this Liz has experience?
Yes.
So are these candidates that had the most experience?
And were the best qualified for the position?
That were the best qualified and had the most experience?
I wouldn't classify as most experienced.
Okay.
Part of the best qualified candidate for the district.
Okay.
And so we're recommending this under all.
Yeah, I get you.
Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained. Motion passes seven zero. B, elementary teacher.
It is recommended that Abigail Roberts is hereby appointed on probation to the academic tenure area of elementary education. The service shall begin on September 1st, 2014, and end on August 31st, 2017. The appointee is certified initial in childhood education, grades 1 through 6, and literacy, birth through grade 6.
Second. Discussion.
Why was this job posted? Ms. Roberts was already a teacher in Hartford, right?
She was hired through BOCES.
Oh, she's hired through BOCES?
She was appointed through BOCES.
Oh, so she's not a teacher in Hartford?
Correct.
Okay.
She was an itinerant position for academic intervention purposes.
Okay.
For
okay, well. All right, when I read this, I see that she's a math AI station at Hartford Central School District. I assume that she's already a teacher. But she's not.
Well, she is a teacher, but she was a paid by us.
Right, because she's not in the Hartford School District.
Staff there in the Hartford Central School District employed by an agency.
Okay, but again, when I read this, I thought that, you know.
I can see that. We should clarify that.
Sure.
Yes.
All right, thanks.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Motion passes seven zero.
Mr. Chairman, I have my daughter's softball team is winning the championship tomorrow. So I thought it was going to be canceled, but not so much. But after some of you just contacted me, if you guys are still going on, after the game is done, I'll come back.
Okay. If I'm easier, if you call the rest of the people, know what I mean, it's better.
That makes me very good. No, I'll text you.
Text me when you're done in a minute. I'll let you know if you should still.
You should know.
Good luck.
Good luck.
Good luck.
Where are you playing? All the way to Gatun Road.
All the way to you.
I'm so smiled now. All the way. Unless it's just back in.
Sorry. C, elementary teacher.
It is recommended that Rochelle Lynch is hereby appointed on probation to the academic tenure area of elementary education. The service shall begin on September 1st, 2014, and end on August 31st, 2016. The appointee is certified permanent in pre-kindergarten in grades 1 through 6.
Second.
Discussion. I have one question. So she received tenure in another district, but it looks like she's only been placed 8 weeks.
She was out of state, and this is an example of a teacher who had over 10 years of experience as a certified and tenured teacher in Virginia.
Oh, can you see this now?
Yeah, was that on there?
Yeah. What did she teach for 10 years?
She taught first grade.
Oh, so she's.
So this is one of the ones I was talking about.
Yeah, she has.
Great.
See, I know, Alan, this is your first time.
What's that? I did not prepare those bench backups.
It was that slacker, Vince. That's way out.
So 10 years, okay.
Teach in first grade.
Teach first grade.
See, I'm tagging on this because I got a first grader in mind.
Yeah, because I saw the same thing, you know, 6 months is here and.
She has fulfilled some long-term positions here in the district, specifically at Miles and.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Motion passes seven zero. Six zero, sorry. D, special education teacher.
It is recommended that Christine Lavera is hereby appointed on probation to the special subject tenure area of special education pending satisfactory clearance for employment by the State Education Department. The service shall begin on September 1st, 2014 and end on August 31st, 2016. The appointee is certified permanent in special education.
Motion.
Move.
Second.
Second.
Discussion.
Yes, why is her, if she's tenured, her appointment is certified permanent in special ed? While we wait for clearance by the state.
She said you said B right now.
Which has been certified teaching public school.
Yeah, we don't know if she's been clarified or certified. We don't know if she's been cleared for that right now. But she taught in a public school prior to the clearance. If she has, then we'll come back, but she wants it. That's why it says it this way.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Motion passes six zero. E, biology slash chemistry teacher.
It is recommended that Jennifer Canal Anel is hereby appointed on probation to the academic tenure area of science pending satisfactory clearance from the employment by the State Education Department. The service shall begin on September 1st, 2014 and end on August 31st, 2017. The appointee is certified initial in general earth science 7 through 12 with an extension in biology 7 through 12.
Motion.
Move.
Second. discussion? All in favor?
Wait, excuse me, this is the position that, okay, yep, yeah, because this is the one where. Yeah, okay, yep.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed, abstained, 6-0. Yes, substitute teacher list.
It is recommended that the following be appointed to the per diem substitute teacher list. Christine Porter, social worker, and Geraldine Smith, elementary, certified K through six.
Move.
Second.
Discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Passes, 6-0. Abstention? Sure. 5-0-1.
Oh, I didn't abstain. Oh, sorry. Oh, you did, oh, sorry. I didn't, yeah.
Right there, you voted against. Somebody to vote to accept your resignation, okay? G, coaches.
It is recommended that the following coaches be appointed for the fall 2014 sports season. Frank Cristiano, assistant varsity football. Kyle Hutchinson, assistant varsity football. Katie Cook, assistant varsity field hockey. Danielle McCary, head gymnastics. And James Carroll, head boys JV soccer.
Motion.
Second.
Discussion?
We appointed three varsity football coaches last time. The head coach and two assistants. No, is there five total pay positions on football?
I'm trying to find the numbers. We appointed two assistants.
Right, and a head.
Yeah.
So this makes five?
Yes.
Is that normal?
Four is, I don't know.
Okay.
I don't think it is.
What do we usually have?
There's usually four. Maybe somebody left out.
Four assistants?
No, three assistants, four total.
I know there's discussion of one of them that isn't, and that could be the reason why.
Could be.
Pardon?
Could be.
That could be the reason why, I just don't know. I'd have to go back and look at last year's, since we had four assistants and one head.
I don't mind approving them, you know, I don't mind approving them, just, you know, if we're gonna increase staff, I'd like to know.
Can you pull out last year's appointment? No, you can, I'll communicate that in this Friday's hours.
Thanks, I'm sure it's somebody leaving.
Yeah. Well, I know there's probably maybe there that one of those assistants will leave.
Okay.
But I don't know if that's the reason, you may have had four assistants last year, or I just, and I had coaches, just don't know.
Okay.
Where's Mr. Carroll from, just curious, James Carroll?
He's a teacher.
Looks like he was an assistant coach at Mohawk. He's at Central Valley Academy right now. It says 2013 assistant coach, Central Valley Academy, and then assistant coach in 2012, so prior to that Mohawk.
And how do these coaches come in now without a, like, athletic director and or?
They were recommended by the former coordinator of athletics.
Okay.
Now we have an interim.
Right.
And we're just included applications June 30th, and the committee is meeting tomorrow, set the process for appointment out for a full-time job.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed, abstained, passes, 6-0. H, part-time grounds.
It is recommended that Dave Reed be appointed to the position of part-time grounds effective July 9, 2014.
Your motion?
Move.
Second.
Second.
Discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed, abstained, motion passes, 6-0. I, bus driver.
It is recommended that Harold Martin be appointed to the position of bus driver effective September 4th, 2014.
Motion.
Move.
Second.
Discussion. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Motion passes 6-0. J, part-time school monitor.
It is recommended that Christine Phelps be appointed to the position of part-time school monitor effective September 4th, 2014.
Motion.
Move.
Second.
Second.
Discussion.
Is this the same Chris Phelps as the brand new?
Yes, this is, yes, it's the one in our position prior to school starting.
So won't her, I think, won't inconvenience her from doing secretary position?
It's the hour prior to her secretarial position starting, yes. So no, it won't, conflict with that.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Motion passes 6-0. K, school monitor.
It is recommended that Diane Laria be appointed to the position of school monitor effective September 4th, 2014.
Motion.
Move.
Second. Discussion. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Motion passes 6-0. Two, reclassifications.
It is recommended that Lisa Greco be classified from the positions of bus aide and school monitor to the position of teacher aide one effective September 4th, 2014.
And motion.
Move.
For a second.
Second.
Discussion. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Motion passes 6-0. Three, return from voluntary layoff.
No.
No, sorry.
It is recommended that Alex Hannah be reclassified from the positions of bus aide, school monitor to the position of DP aide effective September 4th, 2014.
Move.
For a second.
Second.
Discussion. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Motion passes 6-0. C.
It is recommended that Ann Gilio be reclassified from the position of DP aide class L to the position of DP aide class J effective July 1, 2013.
Move.
Second.
Discussion. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Motion passes 6-0. Three, return from voluntary layoff.
The Board of Education acknowledges the assignment of Jessica McNair to resume her duties in the same tenure area of elementary education following return from a voluntary leave of absence under Article 10 of the New Hartford Teachers Association Agreement for the period of September 1st, 2009 through September 1st, 2014.
Move.
Second.
Discussion. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Motion passes 6-0. D, district committee appointments. The Hartford Central School District Committee on Special Education.
Wellness committee?
Move to group, please.
Yeah, can we group, please?
Move to group.
What about number three?
We just did.
Oh, I'm sorry, wellness committee?
Yep. We're on C1.
On C1. Five.
Oh, jeez, I'm sorry, I'm sorry.
You doze off.
No, I understand. Sorry. Wait.
Yeah, is there a motion to group?
Me.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Motion group passes 6-0.
Who's reading that?
There you go.
So you just go through them, right?
You just read them all.
CSC Chair and LEA Representative Ashraf Alam, School Physician Dr. Christopher Alina, Alyssa Lewis, Psychologist, Scott Phelps, Psychologist, Students, Parents or Guardians, Students, Regular Education Teacher, Special Education Teacher. For preschool, special education, CPSE, LEA Representative Chair Ashraf Alam, BOCES CPSE Coordinator Pamela Smolchi, County Representatives, Students, Parents or Guardians, Regular Education Teacher Preschool, and Special Education Teacher Preschool.
motion? Move. Second. Discussion. All in favor?
Just one, yeah, explain under number two, what, they're kind of general, what does that mean? We've got a committee and we're going to have a county representative, student.
Yeah, there are different representatives that come from the county.
But they're not to yet to be named, is that right?
That's true.
So they haven't been named yet?
They change each time.
That's a good.
Child, so that is the representative group. When we discuss that child's location.
And are the name, they, so they, those rotate every year?
Well, it might be from different agencies, so it would be different people. It would be designated from different agencies depending upon the students that are being represented at the meeting.
But that student's regular ed teacher, the student to talk.
Oh, our particular student.
Right, so it's the student's parent, it's like the student's teacher.
This is more like who's going to be in the IEP meeting, right?
Right.
Yeah, now there was a place in here where, I don't know if it was specifically said, but the student's parents could ask for a representative. Okay.
And that's governed by law.
Oh, it's governed by law, so does it, okay. Okay, great.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Passes? Zero. Three, wellness committee.
Wellness committee.
Recommend the wellness committee and outline positions in individual field.
Is this new?
No. We've had a wellness committee policy that is chaired by the assistant superintendent for curriculum. Many times, both students that serve on there have graduated, so they'll have to be selected and come in, PTA representatives, parent representatives. But this is a committee that needs to time to kind of discuss the wellness issues in the school district.
So is there any further, other than that, any further description on what this committee does?
I do a further description on what the committee does, the wellness committee.
You know, basically what the wellness committee does is investigates just that, wellness areas and areas that we would want to work on with initiatives. I know in the past, Tom Pfister's been really involved with that with school lunches, and there's been discussions around.
So is it physical wellness, mental wellness, both?
All of the above.
It has a lot of recent work, I'm sure. The implementation uses form agenda, that's the priority.
Is it typically only, like Beth is only listed, the only listed school board member? Is that typical one?
Yeah, the question is that Beth is on here, isn't that something that you will be appointing to committees? So is that something that should be TBD board?
Yes.
I'm not saying that it won't be Beth, but, right?
I'd say that that would be one of the committees that appoint.
Don't put TBD on that?
Yeah, whatever.
TBD on that.
That's not here?
Sure. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Passes? Zero.
The motion?
Oh.
Second.
Second, she's on the board.
Getting rhythm here.
You're officially in the mix.
It's like Jeff.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Six, zero. P, Committee on Special Education, Preschool Special Education.
The recommendations from the Committee on Preschool Special Education's meetings of June 6, 2014, and June 13, 2014 are presented for approval.
Move.
Second. Discussion. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Passes? Six, zero. P, Committee on Special Education.
The recommendations from the Committee on Special Education's meetings of May 29th, June 3rd, June 6th, June 11th, June 16th, June 19th, and June 24th, all of 2014 are presented for approval.
Move.
Second.
Discussion. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Passes? Six, F, 504 committee.
The recommendations from the 504 committee's meetings of June 3rd, June 11th, June 19th, and June 24th, all of 2014, are presented for approval.
Motion.
Second.
Discussion.
What, just can somebody quickly explain what the 504 committee is?
Students are identified either with an IEP or they have a 504, and that's all governed under Part 200 regulations, which are special education regulations. So some students, based on a disability, will have a 504, which can give them program modifications in the classroom.
Okay, so it could be a physical disability as well as mental, or is it strictly?
Could be both.
And 504 is a classification of disability, so that's why it's a 504 and not the other special ed, as I understand.
So it's just a more, it's a subcategory of this special ed?
I wouldn't say it's a subcategory, I would say it's a.
Separate.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Motion passes six zero. G, musical instrument.
It is recommended that the bid for musical instruments for the 2014-2015 school year be awarded on a per-group basis to each vendor with the lowest bid as presented.
Second.
Second.
Discussion.
This is all budgeted stuff?
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Passes six zero. H, annual reports to the Committee on Special Education and the Committee on Preschool Special Education.
It is recommended that the annual report to the Board of Education 2013-14 school year from the Committee on Special Education be accepted.
Is there a motion?
No.
Second.
Second.
Discussion. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Passes six zero. Number two.
It is recommended that the annual report to the Board of Education 2013-14 school year from the Committee on Preschool Special Education be accepted.
Move.
Second.
Second.
Discussion. Favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Passes six zero. I, appointment of law firms.
It is recommended that the law firms of Hancock and Estabrook LLP, Ferrara Forenza Larison Barrett and Reitz PC, Tabner Ryan Henry LLP, Bond Schoenick and King, and Timothy R. McGill be retained for legal services.
Motion.
Move.
Second.
Second.
Discussion. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Six zero. J, resolution regarding Board of Education and Superintendent Schools Professional Development.
Be resolved that the Board of Education hereby authorizes for the 2014-2015 fiscal year the attendance of board members and superintendent schools at conferences and educational programs and the reimbursement and actual and necessary expenses incurred by any of its members attending those conferences or educational programs.
A motion?
Move.
Second.
Discussion. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Passes six zero. K, authorization to enter into agreement.
Recommend that the Board of Education authorize the superintendent schools to enter into an agreement with the assistant superintendent for curriculum and instruction.
Move.
Second.
Discussion.
Yes. Can we discuss that over the meeting?
We can, unless it's something that should be discussed in the executive session.
Can we discuss it?
L, scholarships.
It is recommended that the list of scholarships as submitted be accepted.
Move. Second.
Are these the scholarships that are given at the senior award night? Okay. And who makes those selections of who gets the scholarship?
It depends on each of the scholarships. I think it all goes through the Springs office and the guidance office. And according to the guidelines set forth in each of the scholarships, if there are guidelines selected.
Are the families involved in this at all? You know, I mean, it's just a discussion regarding getting their family in trust.
I don't believe so. Except for whatever's stipulated.
Criteria.
Yeah, you know, sometimes that should be somebody that participated in certain activities, etc.
Okay.
But if there's a family award here and you run out of money, someone calls them up, qualifies them, and they can either elect to contribute or just say that's their award. So they don't want to handle it.
Depends if it's a perpetual or non-perpetual award. Again, if you don't know.
Well, there's just a couple that are run out of money already, and some very close to running out of them, so I don't know what to handle.
But like, say, for instance, if you're seeing one.
Yeah. I see what you're saying. Fourth up to the bottom?
Yeah, I see that one. It may be stipulated in their contract.
Okay.
The district would never be.
No.
No. No, it's government, it's government.
Are they all listed? I mean, is this all of them? No.
No?
I don't think so, I think. This isn't all.
According to this grant, this is all of them. Well, some of them aren't cash awards, right? Some of them are.
There's times where you have somebody come get an award, like we had a gentleman come from Missouri and have discussion or make a presentation. That wouldn't be here, then they have the financial award.
Right.
This is more financial.
This is what we have that we actually have, that we have full recognition of.
There's one that, you know, the McCallum family, not listed, that I can see.
Yes, it is.
Are they? I'm sorry. Okay, Daniel, got it. Okay, sir. Yeah. That's it.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Stay. Passes 6-0. 6, other business. A, meeting plan change and notification discussion.
Yeah, I brought this up, guys. On May 27th, it was a simple, honest mistake. We changed the date, the time of our meeting from 7 to 6. And a simple mistake. Didn't notify anyone. In keeping with Ben Farrar discussion regarding, you know, this kind of issue, and keeping in mind the transparency issue that we're under the open meetings law, we made a mistake. It was against the open meetings law not to do that. It's no big deal. But I think that if we are to pursue a change in perception, pursue a change in openness and transparency, that we should make an effort similar to what Mr. Farrar recommended, that we call the OB, we say, hey, we made a mistake, you know, on this date. Is there any information that you need? You know, put it in the minutes that, hey, public, this is not the way we do things. You know, we made a simple error, and we always religiously follow the open meetings law when it comes to doing that. But in this case, it was an oversight. And, you know, we're paying particular attention to it. I just think that representing ourselves in that way, no matter how small of an issue, goes a long way for credibility and for openness and transparency, and that would be my recommendation.
Thank you for bringing that to the board's attention. I think I understand what you're saying. I think the difference with the example that Ben Ferrara brought up was, in this instance, if anyone thought the meeting was at 7 instead of 6, we were still here at 7. So it's not, I think Ben's example had to do with actually a different date. So if someone showed up at the meeting, there was an empty room. So it would be, while I agree that, you know, the notification process wasn't ideal, I think it would be a little disingenuous for someone to say, I thought the meeting was at 7 and I didn't know it changed.
we were here at 7, and if they showed up, they would have been. But I appreciate you bringing it to the board's attention. If the board would like to take any action, I would entertain a motion at this time.
Yeah, I'll tell you, if you want a motion.
So I guess I'm looking for direction for the board, whether or not we want to reach out to the OD, or if any action is required.
At this point, I think it's a little bit, if you saw the mistake, and whatever, how would we know that it was the end?
There was a meeting this past spring that we were not meeting, and they had, the union had put in the newspaper that his contract was going to be presented at town court, and that was never the particular thing, whether they got the information from that. We had notified the OD through the notification requirements where they published them, and they didn't take it off, and they said there was a glitch in their system, and they advised us to email the reporter directly. Fine. On the May 27th meeting, I presented to the Board of Education an email that indicated we notified the OD and the reporter on May 22nd that we need up the meeting a few times, and they didn't publish it at 6 o'clock. So we did notify the media.
With the agenda, right?
Yeah.
The agenda.
The agenda's at 6 o'clock on it.
I understand that, Bob, but you know that's not the procedure. The procedure is that you go to the OD website and you input the time and the date.
And I told you, we did that with the prior board meeting, and changed the date and time appropriately, and they still published that we had a meeting that day and time. And they said Vince Condro would be presenting on Common Core. But we didn't hold the meeting. We had put up notices on all our buildings. We had to publish something on our website. We only put in a correction afterwards on page 2 that there was correction, that there was no meeting.
Again.
We followed exactly what they told us in this time. We notified them just the way they articulated to us and told us there was a glitching system.
Okay.
So we notified them.
There were other issues.
Well,
I mean, listen, I don't even know why we're, again, I just see things, a little bit more black and white. Agenda, you know, it was still on the outside board, you know, in front of Bradley before the meeting.
All right, well, let's do this. So,
I mean,
brought to the board's attention. If the board would like us, if the board desires to take action on this, we can do that. If it's not the board's desire, then it's not.
Right.
So if someone would like to make a motion for us to take action on that, that's fine.
I make a motion to just simply notify the OD that the meeting was held at 6. If there's any information that they need from that meeting that they didn't get, we're more than happy to give it to them. And make some meeting in these minutes that people can pick up on our website that simply says, you know, we didn't notify them like we should have. Sorry, if there's anybody that needs any information from that meeting, let us know. That's it.
Is there a second? Discussed it. Yeah, it's. I don't feel strongly either way. I think it's kind of a moot point, especially because we were here at 7 o'clock. So if they showed up at 7, we were here. But that being said, if there is ever a question of transparency and it's not a big issue, why not fault on the side of transparency? I would not say that we violated the open meetings law because Bob clearly showed that we did notify the meeting. So there may have been a glitch in the system, but I don't think that we should be admitting that there was some violation on our part. Now maybe there was a glitch and so we want to be overly transparent and we reach out to them. So that would be my two cents. So anyway, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Against?
Aye.
No.
What happened to the
tie? Motion was carried in majority of 4.
Okay. Next, discussion of forming interscholastic athletic ad hoc committee. So this was brought up by Paul, the concept of, you know, we have a lot of standing committees. This would be the same as a standing committee, but not permanent. We don't know if it's going to be needed forever. I guess my question to the board is, do you feel this committee is needed? If it is needed, what is its goal? What is its charge? What will it do?
Can I speak to that? The idea is that, first, it will not be a sounding off for, I heard this in the community, and I heard this, this person's not playing, somebody else is getting more minutes or more playing time. Because we're going to be having a new director of athletics and a new secretary in that office, there's a big transition stage. Bob met with Pete Oakley last week, really, right? Okay, that's a lot on his shoulders. And he can still, I don't know if you're still going to meet weekly, or you're not going to, because I don't know if your schedule's going to be. I'm just proposing this so that we can talk with this person, it could be on a monthly, quarterly basis, find out how they're doing, what their needs might be, that this new person might come in. I have needs for something, I need some money for something, speaking directly to us. If something goes wrong within the athletic department, and I'm thinking about the example last spring when the football field had snow on it, and our kids couldn't play on our own field, we had to pay for them to go to other fields, why wasn't the snow removed? If that comes up, I'd like to hear, where was the communication problem, what happened? That's the type of thing I think I would like to discuss with the athletic director, or something else might come up. Maybe once in a while bring in a coach, I can bring in department chairs in front of the curriculum committee, and just discuss things, have conversation between the people out there, rather than hearing it from all over the place.
You can handle the swimsuit issue.
No, not from that.
Well, what we were talking about a little bit, I don't know, a little bit in there when we had some dinner, is that perhaps, I'm just saying this, we want to expand and say athletics and extracurricular activities. I don't know if that's something that you want to move in that category too. I was just saying, you know, Tim Crow gives a report to staff and curriculum about all the extracurricular activity participation in athletics and whatever. Maybe that's something that would be for that committee. I'm not.
So be that ad committee on extracurricular activity.
Paul, I understand where you're coming from. I really do, man. I've had a lot of issues. But at the end of the day, I think this exceeds, you know, what the board does. This is a Bob Knoll, superintendent of the schools, managing the athletic department with a new athletic director. And, you know, coming to the board, I think there might be some slippery slopes and confusion regarding who they're going to come to get things done, what the board can actually do for this athletic director of the athletic department. We can do nothing other than through Bob. I just don't want to confuse them. I think the structure's in place to handle it, just like any other department, just like the math department. And I think, you know, with the right candidate, they should be able to hit the ground running with Bob to make it happen.
Well, Pat, I agree with you that it's not necessarily, that it's definitely not our place to direct, but I agree with Paul, it's our place to support. And it's no different than having a curriculum committee or wellness committee, not really sure what that does, but as a support committee, especially given that we talked about in our goals that that's a weakness of ours. We've had a lot of issues in the past. I think we can act as a liaison to the community. Potentially, this new AD may be from outside our district and not know this district. And so, shouldn't we be a liaison support committee, you know, kind of forming, no different than any other committee that we have in terms of supporting data? If it's a goal, we need to gather the data. How have we done in the past? What do we expect this new AD or this athletic department or this extracurricular department to do in the future, and how do we measure that? So I think that's where the committee could really come into play.
I got you. And I don't disagree with either one of you guys on that. I really don't. I just don't have it clear in my mind what I guess the objective,
well, that's what we need
what
to
the
define.
Objective of the committee is.
Maybe putting together, like we have here, the following report committees, respective committee tasks, maybe add some kind of a paragraph on what the committees, like you said, what their charge would be, you know, maybe that would be helpful. Maybe that's something that we could put together, and maybe we could then vote on it the next.
And I appreciate all of your opinions, because it says here's for discussion of forming, it's not set in stone.
Yep.
I would rather go the recommendation from the staffing or let it be discussed there. Well, I don't know, because they could discuss it.
Well, I think it's more of a board decision. My only concern is, you know, we have a lot of committees, we have a lot of committee meetings, and so we're talking about adding another committee. I'm all for it as long as it has a defined purpose, and it's not just another.
Right, well, it doesn't have to meet monthly, quarterly, it's probably fine.
But it might be, you know, I mean, you know, we certainly don't want to have a situation where the new guy comes in and we don't have confidence that the certification sheets that he's presenting to us, you know, he has his house in order. I don't know if that's the committee that would be.
What if I came back next meeting, whatever, with a charge, I'll try and get to that time.
I'll help you if you want.
Write a letter.
I'll help you if you want.
And then you can say, no, we don't think so, that's fine.
And I think what I would say is, because this is another committee, I would only consider putting people on the committee that want to be on, because this is an additional committee assignment. So I feel funny about putting somebody on another committee.
Okay, great.
Yeah, again, coffee, some help, we have a meeting, man, thank.
Any other business?
Yes, I have nine items for executive session.
Are you kidding?
Oh, I'm sorry, I do have one more thing, I'm sorry.
Sorry, I have another. Sort of, this is a segue into one of my committee assignments. How are you going to do that? Are you going to just list some committees, or do you want to get input from us, or?
If you have strong feelings about something, give them to me, some you already have.
Okay.
You know, I would try to do my best to everybody not to do it.
And my second thing, I know we talked about the Board of Education, the bylaws of the Board of Education. I know at our meeting, one of our goal sessions, we talked about also the standards of conduct that we have. Are we gonna, I'd like to talk about those, because there were some things that were, again, procedural in board meetings, for example, I don't have it in front of me, but that the president is the only one that, you know, responds to something from the public. Are we gonna like sort of look at those and codify and change or do those too as well? Or is that a policy thing, or how does it work?
If that's what the board wants, you know, I think, and I'm spitballing, the way my mind works, the difference between a meeting when there's three people in the audience and when there's 50 people. You know, when you have 50 people in the audience, I think you need a much more rigid set of, okay, everybody has your 5 minutes, I'd have Paul keeping the time, you know, everybody stand up in a line there so we know how many people are gonna speak, and kind of keep it going and have a much more formal meeting, because you have to keep order. And in that case, I would say yes, if board members want, you know, everything should go to the chair. But when it's more of an informal setting, I would like to think we're all professionals and we kind of self-regulate.
Well, but again, you don't want to get into, the purpose of the comments from the visitors is to, correct me if I'm wrong, but to make a comment. They're not involved in this meeting.
Right.
You know, so there shouldn't be any kind of discussion with them. And again, I think there should be, again, everyone wants to be a policy. If the policy is that you're the only one that talks to the visitors, then that's what it should be. I think everybody wants everything.
Actually, it's in the bylaws.
Right.
It's in the bylaws, how that operates. The president can either designate somebody to answer, or that person says, hey, I'd like to answer it.
I mean, again, I am happy to run meetings as strictly or as loosely as the board wants. What I don't want to do is, you know, be seen as trying to stifle a board member or, you know, not allow dialogue.
All I'm not saying that. All I'm saying is that in this packet, today, we got a thing of the bylaws of the Board of Education, and we all looked at them and talked to you about what we think are the authority of the board president, etc.
Okay.
All I'm saying is that there's 75 codes, things that are code of conduct in a meeting, and I think it would behoove us to take a look at those and make sure we're all on the same page as we start this meeting.
I agree with that.
Okay.
Anything else?
Yeah, one more thing that came up, Pam and I were discussing in between meetings here. Is there anything that the board, Paul and I are on this search committee for an AD. Guys, is there anything you want to leave us with as we go to our first meeting tomorrow from the board? Is there something that you don't, you know, want us to look for, something that you, I don't know, is there any direction from you guys that we can attempt to?
Well, from my standpoint, I was telling you, and I was interested in being on this committee, but I totally respect John's decision, you know, who he selected. I think it's a good group. From my perspective, I think we need to have like a full perspective of this group. And I'm not talking about with the beginning set, but maybe as it gets down to, you know, the last few candidates, I think it's important, because this is a very visible position to the community, to understand how that person was viewed in their own community, wherever they might be coming from. So how we collect that information, I'm not sure, but if those candidates or those final candidates might be shared with us and where they're from, there might be some other input from outside, if you guys are willing to, you know, take that input. For example, they're from Western New York, and we know coaches there, or we know family there, or we know somebody who knows this from the community standpoint and how that particular candidate is perceived in their community as a leader, as a program director for athletics, how they relate to the community. I think that's important, which wouldn't necessarily show in the interview process, wouldn't necessarily show on paper, because they're going to obviously put their best foot forward, but kind of getting some... Not just reference checks, I think, from, you know, it's the athletic director in Buffalo, New York, and we happen to have, you know, family there that have been in athletics with this person, and know. I don't know. We wouldn't necessarily always have that, and certainly we want to be objective, but all the more reason we want to know full scope of where this person is coming from.
The tricky part is, in any school district, the athletic director is probably one of the most polarizing. You know, you're going to have people that love and hate them, because it's just the nature of athletics.
I hear where you're coming from.
Yes and no,
I
mean, but I'm just...
It's more of a performance. Intangible. It's a performance issue. You know what I mean? They're trying to get a handle on, you know, how the community might feel, not just the references. I don't know how a search committee does that.
Right.
I mean, you know what I mean?
What I would be looking for in someone, these statements are not an indication of performance. This is... One, the person needs to be very organized, very professional, and be the kind of person that doesn't add fuel to a fire, has a calming effect, because there's going to be conflict, and they have to be able to be the kind of person that turns the temperature down, not turns it up. It has to be, it's a service position. The parents are customers, the students are customers, have to be giving good customer service, return phone calls, that kind of thing. I think that would be kind of big picture, the kind of personality
traits that you look for.
But also looking at how well that person has built programs, not just sports areas, but across all aspects of
the process.
But it's something to pay attention to. Now, these are questions that certainly could be asked of members. How do you perceive the community's, you know, satisfaction in your service?
And if you guys could report back to us, there are many things out here.
Sure. You guys want like an update, a little update every time?
Yeah, I'd be great.
Sure.
Okay.
I'd like to see the space memo. My charge. Grabs.
All right.
Fence ball, soccer ball, one thing.
Exactly.
Okay. Any items, kids items, three percent recollect negotiations, one matter regarding proposed litigation, two matters regarding current litigation, two matters leading to the appointment of the person, and one matter leading to the evaluation of the person. Can I have a motion going to executive session? Second. Okay.
All right.
We'll go to executive session at 7:00.
Really,
yes, I'm tough.
That is definitely a call.